So in part three of the police state, we're going to learn about a global dictatorship sworn to enslave every man, woman, and child. It's time to wake up to the facts that the U.S. government has fallen under the control of the New World Order. 9/11 merely marked the beginning of the final phase of the Illuminati scheme to consolidate global power. And only Alex Jones and the information that you're about to see stands between the United States and a complete collapse of our wonderful, beautiful republic. So let's find out what the globalists are up to this time. I don't think Grace watches the Alex Jones content. I think she's a performative whack job. It's always this music, and it always gets a content ID from the Chicago Orchestra. I'm drinking pink lemonade. That's okay. You can be committed to it.
Fear the United States, for you will lose your liberty.
What an explosive start to this thing. That's what I was thinking. I was kind of curious if they were going to reuse a bunch of footage again or if there was enough. I mean, this has got to be after 9/11. Yeah. I watched a documentary last night on Canopy called New World Order, and Alex Jones was in it, but it covered like a bunch of the 9/11 conspiracy theorists.
Hello, I'm Alex Jones. I'm a syndicated radio and television host based in Austin, Texas.
Hello.
For many years, I've been exposing the criminal activities of the global elite, also known as the New World Order. I remember 5 years ago being on the radio and reading UN documents on the air that were public and having callers call in and say, there is no New World Order. The news said so. They said dangerous people. Talk about it. And I'd say, excuse me, there's a World Bank. There's a world court. You don't have juries. You can't face your accusers.
I can't get
this
a good angle.
This is run by a group of elite families. They're the shareholders of XYZ Bank. Well, people don't call my syndicated show anymore and disagree with that fact, because now in the news they admit, yes, there's a world government.
He puts more bass in his voice when he does the wrestler voice.
So let's look at the new
world order
and what
it has in
store for you
and your family. In the older, like Austin Public Access days, his voice wasn't gravelly like that.
I assure you, my friends, it is nothing less than total enslavement. We'll look at the type of cashless society control grid they're putting in, the destruction of the Bill of Rights and Constitution in America, the disarmament of the people, the end of national sovereignty, the militarization of police, and yes, the concentration camps that are a fact, not rumor, but fact. The documentation begins, the rumors end right here on the show today.
I don't know.
Here are some clips of world leaders and political pundits calling for a new world order. And you'll also see a clip at the Council on Foreign Relations just days after September 11, 2001, where Gary Hart says we need to use this disaster to get a new world order. Again, using crises.
Gary Hart?
Many times crises the government engineers to scare the people into accepting tyranny. the new
Does
world.
Does Gary Hart have any clout in 2001?
Bill, you've heard an awful lot of dramatic speeches and seen dramatic moments in times of great gravity for the nation. How would you assess this evening?
Well, first of all, notice that he is hugging the majority leader, a Democrat of the United States Senate, Tom Daschle, in a clear display of bipartisanship. This was a stirring address, in my view, shorter than his father's speech when he announced the New World Order.
What is at stake is more than one small country. It is a big idea, a new world order. Out of these troubled times, our fifth objective, a new world order, can emerge. Now we can see a new world coming into view. A world in which there is the very real prospect of a new world order.
The soldiers that you see before you.
Now show what Bush thought the new world order was.
It is through exercises such as this that truly we can create a new world order.
And Americans are brilliant at many things, not least of which is turning lemons into lemonade. There is a chance for the President of the United States to use this disaster to carry out what his father, a phrase his father used, I think only once, and hasn't been used since, and that is a new world order. Think about this.
Let's first look a little bit closer at the new world order and its system. By the turn of the 21st century, one could no longer ignore the fact that we were living inside a new world order. The question is, what degree of global tyranny, what degree of dehumanization and total enslavement will you accept? A headline in MSNBC read, "Is this the new world order?" The New York Times went further with the headline, "Nations seek world order centered on UN, not US." They continued to say that the EU leaders had a meeting that was saturated with a commitment to what may be viewed as a form of world government, the supervision of countries by an international civil service bureaucracy whose headquarters is the United Nations.
Okay, here we go.
We're talking about a global tax, a global court where there are no juries, where you cannot face your accuser, where you're guilty until proven innocent, where the judge and the prosecutor sit on the same side of the bench working together. And inside this new world order, there's no room for freedom.
But still,
the man on the street may deny that there even is a
world. I'm trying to open this file about the new world order.
And that's really, well, the devil's biggest trick.
Oh, shit, this is a fucking research paper from 1997.
Convincing the world that he doesn't exist. Well, the new world order's certainly done the same thing. It's like a deer who's stunned in the headlights, who just hesitates a moment and is smashed into a bloody pulp. Another headline in Salon magazine read, "Europe's New World Order," and began to try to create this illusion that, oh, there's a choice between what type of New World Order you want to live in. You see, the globalist social architects and engineers, the propaganda masters, know that they can no longer keep the existence of this world government
from
you.
So
they're saying, okay, there is a world government. But there's a left-wing
for like
world government
five different
and a right-wing
meanings
world
of
government,
what Bush was
and
trying
you have
to say.
A choice world.
I think
what type
he meant it as like a
Who's
generic
going to control the new world order, and they completely
catch-all for
any discussion,
you know,
of
us
being
hey,
we don't want
a
new world order. We want to keep our rights, keep our freedoms,
part of a larger
keep our
coalition,
heritage, keep our nationalism.
But clearly, some people think it.
So
means,
think about that. 5 years ago, there isn't a new world order. You're a kook to talk about it. You shouldn't get involved
giving
in
all
it.
The power to the Bohemian Grove.
It doesn't exist. You're crazy if you think it exists. And now, oh yeah, there's a new world order, world government. But okay, folks, what type of world government do you want? Now that's just on the surface. There is no left-wing or right-wing world government. It was founded and chartered by the military-industrial complex in San Francisco in 1945. It is nothing but a debaters club to basically steer and control the third world. The UN plays the good cop in military affairs, while the former Soviet Union and the United States play bad cop as the global government is expanded. Now you see the EU, the Pan-American Union, and the Asian Union that were formed decades ago merging their currency systems and their laws. And still, the average American, the average European, the average Asian has no idea that this system has already taken control of their lives. A lengthy 31-page report in the national newspaper of Australia, the Sydney Morning Herald, read, Manifesto for World Dictatorship. And in the article, they call for a liberal world government controlled by the United Nations and announce that the bad cop is America running the fascistic world domination racket. But if you inspect the IMF, the World Bank, the finances and controls, the UN, the central banks,
I know that like the UN
does around
have
the
some,
world,
like,
you look at the World Trade Organization,
has
the
some
World
teeth,
Health Organization, it's all
but
funded,
it's so
shared,
selective.
And run
I don't
by a
think
tiny
anybody out there really fears the UN or
the
international, you know, the ICC
that also owns the military industrial complex. So again, they've spun the debate.
So
to
I don't really buy the UN
as
the new world order.
The UN and the World Council of Churches has been calling and writing the textbooks for a one world religion, billing that as the only hope for world peace. Meanwhile, the global government finances and runs and provocateurs almost every known terror organization on the face of the planet. There are countless other headlines drilling it into our heads that there's some type of transatlantic battle over the shape of the New World Order. Again, sucking you into phony debates to make you think you have input on this process if you'll just accept the New World Order. But what will it be like living under the New World Order? A United Press International headline read, Israel to kill in U.S. and allied nations. The FBI didn't have any comment about it. Ariel Sharon says that, yes, he'll kill citizens of America or any other country wherever he wants, including the United States. And our government, the federal government, has signed agreements with the EU to extradite American citizens for things that aren't even crimes here. Thought crimes, namely criticizing the EU or any of their policies, is now considered xenophobic.
What?
Imagine foreign Mossad and Interpol agents murdering Americans. No judge, no jury, no arrest. You're just dead, and it's in the back of the newspaper. That, my friends, is what it'll be like living inside the New World Order, and it's happening
right now. If there was a New World Order, wouldn't we not find out about this?
We see leaders from Mexico, the U.S., Canada, Chile, calling for getting rid of our borders, merging our social security systems and our police and military. Deals have already been signed in late 2002 for, quote, Mexican and Canadian troops to deal with American terrorists and for peacekeeping. My friends, peacekeeping is the disarmament and enslavement of the people. The New World Order also allows European Union-controlled and financed corporations to buy up critical government services like waste water and electricity. Privatization isn't private at all. It is simply a partnership between select corporations that act more like organized
crime. Yeah, now he's on the right path. I mean, that to me is what the closest thing to it. Oh man, I remember that footage.
An important area of New World Order documents.
I mean, I'm more worried about corporations than anything else, really.
And their writings are public, though they're not distributed widely or talked about in the mainstream controlled press that is there to distract our attention away from issues of real substance. The Project for a New American Century, founded in 1997, was run by Dick Cheney, Jeb Bush, Wolfowitz, and, of course, Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld. And the Project for a New American Century called for a New World Order in its writings that can be viewed at their website. They said that there needed to be a, quote, Pearl Harbor event to speed up the New World Order and to get the American people behind a national draft and behind a war of aggression.
Well, a lot of people now
countries,
are
a war that,
like,
Bush has said
not,
will last generations. In
hypothetical
fact, in
people,
statement,
but actual people are saying that, like, they hope that
years.
Trump gets elected because
they,
think that
that
will accelerate
a
resistance or whatever. And I think that's
dossier
bullshit.
They wrote up. A 2000 barrel plan that Saddam Hussein wasn't
why they
a threat,
think it would be
but that
easier
he provided
to
a convenient pretext
enact it that way.
To get
I mean,
the oil
just,
in Iraq. To understand
I don't
the invasion
I mean,
of Iraq
I understand it in,
also,
in principle. I don't understand it in practice.
$5 trillion
in
oil,
in this instance.
Or the 1.7 to 1.9 trillion occupation cost of Iraq over the next 5 years. It was also about setting the precedent for the New World Order to invade sovereign nations. And if you think there's some rift between Bush and the UN, Bush and Blair have already announced that the UN will control the oil, the trillions of dollars of oil that the Iraqi people truly own. So again, playing good cop, bad cop, and we have them on the record saying, think about this, that they were gonna go after Iraq, they need a Pearl Harbor event to get the American people behind it. And the military-industrial complex, the CIA, certainly provided that on 9-1-1, September 11, 2001. But the New World Order also goes back into history. They orchestrated World War I, and they've bragged about it. And they tried to get their League of Nations, the first UN. When that failed, they needed a bigger war. And they certainly generated that with their asset, Adolf Hitler, who they funded and trained. In fact, I have the news articles out of large establishment East Coast newspapers from the early 1940s where the president's grandfather, George Bush's grandfather, Prescott Bush, actually was arrested and fined for trading with the enemy, running over 50% of Nazi steel production through Brown Brother Harriman. In fact, a headline on MSNBC reported that FDR's Auschwitz secret, well, I'd talked to many B-17 pilots years ago who said they weren't allowed to bomb entire factories owned by General Motors, General Electric, and Ford building panzers for Hitler's war. Why did the globalists do this? Because the bankers were funding both sides and they stood to gain and profit from a protracted war. The bankers funded Stalin, Hitler, and the United States.
I understand his rationale for why he thinks a government would want something like that to happen. I don't understand why, citizens
that Hitler saw the Duke of Windsor, the man who would be king, as no enemy. U.S. files
advantage for them.
Well, of course, the Duke of Edinburgh lived in Germany during most of World War II, and then escaped near the end to fascist Franco Spain. The British have engineered these disasters time and time again by controlling both sides of conflicts. They take over in the aftermath. And who's one of the main banking families behind major wars, going back to the Battle at Waterloo? The Rothschild family, the family that bankrolled Europe. And every time we investigate a major scandal or a company being sucked dry before being imploded and pension funds being stolen, we run right into the Rothschild family, namely their British subsidiary, N.M. Rothschild. You also have the Krupp family in Germany that owns many of the publishing companies in the world. They weren't prosecuted after World War II.
Oh,
certainly
boy.
Not. Their little creation, Adolf Hitler, and his minions were. And now we have the modern New World Order system. In March of 2002, I interviewed BBC reporter Greg Palast. He said the head of N.M. Rothschild, Lord Wakeham, who's on the head of Britain's censorship board, was trying to...
Look at this. His reference thing is World Bank secret documents consumes Argentina. And then underneath of it, Alex Jones interviews. Alex Jones, this is earth-shattering. Can you break it down for us and tell us what the economists have done? So he's referencing, as if it's an indisputable source, his own work.
Restrict him from breaking the story of 1,000 plus pages of secret World Bank and IMF documents. Mr. Palast interviewed the former head economist for the World Bank, Joseph Stiglitz. The former chief economist of the World Bank, Mr. Stiglitz, reported that the World Bank and IMF planned to implode the world economy. You see, the globalists print the money. They gain their power out of creating bubbles, then bursting those bubbles, creating depressions and recessions, and getting control of assets, corporations, and private property. The globalists control the boom and bust system. IMF unveils details of a plan for international bankruptcy system. What a scam. They go into third world countries, their documents show, pay off the leadership to not pay their debts, and then to sign over the natural resources and the population themselves, as well as their public lands.
I can totally believe this stuff, but I would just believe it's just, that's just greed. I don't think it's part of a
Think about the erosion
cabal.
Of America's
I just think
sovereignty.
There are a lot of people
we
in this
Mexico
world who
going
will
to the
do anything for money.
To intervene on behalf of Mexicans on death row in the U.S. And guess what
so
the
like,
world
yeah,
court did?
So, like, yeah, I think
did.
They would try
they
to influence,
US
like,
Supreme
markets,
court
but
to freeze
not
Mexican
for the
execution.
Purposes he's talking
and guess
about.
What? The Supreme Court did exactly
that. They just want all
that.
The money.
Ruth Bader Ginsburg said, oh, we definitely agree that you are the authority. Already, our courts under the control of the United Nations. And we have the International Criminal Court coming to life, and it doesn't even respect the basic rights contained in the Magna Carta, much less the Bill of Rights or Constitution. Meanwhile, we have the Pan-American Union forming, merging social security systems, merging law enforcement and military, as we said earlier. The EU is doing the same thing at the same time. EU poised for huge expansion to the east, 10 former Eastern Bloc nations merging with the EU, and they're quite at home in the socialist system. Another pretext the world government uses to get involved in sovereign nations is the drug war.
Uh-oh,
and the evidence is clear. MI6, the CIA, Mossad, and other major intelligence agencies control the drug trade globally. In fact, after the globalists took over Afghanistan, opium production surged to record levels.
Yep.
That was another one of the little motives behind 9-1-1. Not just oil, not just weapon sales, not just the pretext to invade sovereign nations and empower this world government, but also that key belt of opium production.
He's right. That's actually
before
true.
Before
9-1-1,
only about 10%
anyway.
Of opium was being produced there with the poppies. Now it's over 60%. You know, I've been very frustrated in the 8 documentary films that I produced because I could spend an entire program just covering one aspect of the New World Order. But to understand the total enslavement system they're designing for you and your family that we're already deep into, but it's getting worse in the degrees, you need to have an understanding of the entire system
we gotta
and how
have those, we
fits
gotta
together
have
in this web of tyranny and slavery. A key area that we need to look at is government-sponsored terrorism. How do the globalists get us to accept giving up our liberties and freedoms? Well, it's simple. They scare the daylights
opiates.
Out of us with terrorist events they create. They pose as our saviors. We go to them asking for help, and they give us solutions that get the chains more tightly fitted to our ankles and mainly to our minds. Let's look at just a few examples of this, and they are voluminous.
Oh my God.
I would just hope that everyone out there visit Infowars.com on a daily basis to see even more examples of this. A long time ago in my study, I discovered that white supremacist, Hispanic supremacist organizations, almost all racial organizations in the world are actually founded, not just funded and controlled, by the globalist, by the MI6 / CIA Mossad control arm. Whether it's Hamas, which Yitzhak Rabin, a former he was assassinated, Israeli prime minister, admitted. In fact, UPI and Reuters and Haaretz, a major Jewish newspaper, have now admitted this. Why would Israel found Hamas, the group that engages in terror bombings? Because then the military state, military dictatorship that oppresses Jews as well as Palestinians, gets to maintain its control over the Middle East. It's its pretext for attacking its neighbors, expanding its boundaries, having police state controls, censorship over the Israeli media. This is how they maintain control. I mean, why does the mob, you know, burn down your grocery store so you'll buy protection from them? I mean, it's really simple. But with neo-Nazis especially, there's been cases here in Texas. They caught them in Fort Worth. The FBI created a Klan group back in the late 90s, tried to get them to blow up a chemical plant. The sheriff found out and stopped it. Now, there have been countless examples that we've covered, but it just came out that the modern neo-Nazi groups in Germany were founded in 1963 by MI6, British intelligence, and it just broke in German courts that the entire leadership of the National Democratic Party, MPD, who's been caught firebombing people, murdering folks, in Germany, the entire leadership, the top 30 people, and it's a small organization, a little over 200 members, The entire leadership, those that print the newspaper, that give the orders, that have the rallies, are German intelligence. So it's not German intelligence inside the MPD, it's German intelligence running it, and it was of course founded by their bosses, MI6. And it admits in the Scotsman and BBC and London Telegraph headlines that the government ran the organizations as agent provocateurs paid by intelligence services. And why did it come out in court that the government was doing this?
I think to create it would be fear neat if whenever so Germany he's calm, could pass they would laws play like
restricting
the chill,
everyone's mobility,
Oblivion
everyone's
or Skyrim
freedom,
music,
banning
and
other
then he starts
mainstream
to get agitated,
political
play
organizations
the music that, plays like
that are
when you
nationalist
aggro
in Germany that are standing up for that government sovereignty against EU expansion. So it's simple. You want everybody to give their rights up? You create Nazis who go out and kill some people. The government goes, oh, look, they're dangerous. Let us take your rights to keep you safe. And they've been caught doing it. Same thing just came out in England. Turns out that MI5, okay, MI6, and Army intelligence officers have gone public. That the British government pays Al-Qaeda hundreds of thousands of dollars in the 90s to carry out assassinations all over the world, little proxy groups. Intelligence agencies love to use organized crime and terrorist groups they created to carry out their terror. And officers went public on this. They quit. Some of them were jailed over it. The government didn't deny the facts of what they said, but they would arrest them. And it turns out that almost all the bombings in London and in Ireland over the last 24 years, since 1980, were conducted by different arms of British intelligence. They didn't even provocateur it. They weren't just the heads of it, which they were. They didn't have somebody else go do it. They actually bombed buses and churches and buildings. And why? As an excuse to have a crackdown police state in London and all over England, and to keep a military occupation force in Northern Ireland.
I feel like this is a lot
Ireland.
Of work.
It's incredible.
For the Rothschilds,
and this was just calmly
you know?
Announced.
Like, I feel like they have so much money
British
that they could do
in
a better job of
early 2003.
Building an
and then
efficient
as soon as the stories appeared, they disappeared. The government never refuted it. They admitted it was
will.
True. In fact, the government said, well, we wanted to look legitimate to the terrorist groups, so we did this, but they founded and controlled the groups. And again, use that fear to control the country. It's been in our news as well that in Georgia, law officers involved with supremacists.
Now, that's not surprising. It's not surprising
that
white supremacists would be in the military, in my opinion.
But let's look at some even more serious geopolitical versions
of crisis creation. I don't think that points
to
anything.
We've all heard about North Korea threatening to nuke their neighbors.
On a global level, though, it just means in America we have some white supremacists in our police and military.
But did you know that it was the U.S. government, Republican and Democrat administrations, they're all together on these key issues, armed North Korea with the reactors that could produce upwards of 100 nuclear warheads a year. They also helped transfer computers and missile systems to China illegally under Clinton
fast.
And now under Bush. He's gotten rid of all the restrictions. And somehow the neocons don't have a problem with that. It's crazy. It's out Clinton and Clinton. That's all being transferred to North Korea, being transferred to Pakistan, who's threatening India. And out of this whole global destabilization, now they're talking about universal drafts and wars with all these countries. North Korea threatens to destroy the world. But we're supposed to forget the headlines. Clinton deal gave North Korea 100 nuke per year capacity. But wait, then the Republicans say it's just the Democrats. Oh no, it's the whole government. It turns out Donald Rumsfeld, who was also the bag man in the 80s arming Saddam with chemicals and biologicals, was on the board of ABB, the company that delivered this nuclear technology to North Korea in the late 1990s. Think about that. This guy's the super gopher of the New World Order for weapons of mass destruction proliferation. And then he's the guy that tells us we've got to give up our liberties or the terrorists are going to get us. I think we know the terrorist is you, Mr. Rumsfeld.
I think
you're the
he
one
did a really interesting
for
sit-down interview.
America. Just incredible. Also, during the whole war with Iraq, that staged event, the U.S. government kept a tight lid on a story that was front page in South Korea. The Taipong-Tong-2 intermediate-range missile that can hit areas of the U.S. western seaboard actually launched a test missile, North Korea did, They've done it many times in Japan, and that's public. But they launched a test missile that hit Alaska.
Oh, it's just a spam.
That's right. First, they were reporting that it splashed down hundreds of miles off our coast. Then it turned out that pieces of it actually hit Alaska. And why did our government keep that quiet? How could we invade Iraq and say they were more of a threat than anybody else when North Korea is threatening to nuke us and launching test missiles and hitting Alaska, our 49th state? And this came out, of course, out of official South Korean newspapers. Why did they release this news? They were told to be quiet by the U.S. government. They're afraid. They want the world to know what a threat North Korea is. And at the same time, the Associated Press reported that still, as North Korea is threatening to nuke us, U.S. providing North Korea with nuke info, while the Bush administration confronts North Korea over developments of nuclear weapons, it is allowing the regime access to thousands of documents on nuclear technology as part of an electronic power project. And then you see headlines about how dangerous Iran is. We've got to invade Iran next. Iran has, you know, these enriched uranium plants, very, very advanced. But there's a problem. We're supposed to forget the confirmed news reports from the BBC and other publications that the UK, the US, and Israel transferred Iran these systems in the 1990s, right up until 2001. And why are they proliferating? Because then they got to have this global government and this global army to keep us safe from all of these different threats. There was a great headline and an interesting story, very informative, out of the Sydney Morning Herald. Back in August 7th of 2002, U.S. is putting North Korea's finger on the nuclear trigger. I couldn't say any more simply or succinctly myself. Now, remember Bill Clinton? He got in all
remember
that trouble.
Bill
He's
Clinton.
A horrible traitor to America, a globalist. They're talking about making him Secretary General now, and Clinton and Bush will double-team us. But then when Bush got in, he took all restrictions off transfers to China.
Alex Jones ready
and
for the
neocons, who aren't about substance, who are the biggest socialist of them all, said, oh, that's okay if Bush does that. You talk about Orwellian doublethink. There was a great story, though, in the Washington Times, out of Insight Magazine, one of their publications, that said, high-tech transfers to China. The Bush administration has been as bad, if not worse, than the Clinton administration when it comes to the transfer of sensitive technologies to the People's Republic of China. That's right. We should all be angry about that. The Buffalo News reported on the 1994 Senate report of the transfer of West Nile virus, E. coli, anthrax, botulism, VX, sarin nerve gas to Iraq in the 1980s, right up until 1990. We're supposed to forget about that, aren't we? Well, I'm not going to forget about who armed our enemies. U.S. supplied germs to Iraq, but that's okay, because now the globalists get to steal their oil after they set Saddam up for this. You know, it's like the old Westerns where the evil sheriff throws down the gun, you know, in front of the 14-year-old kid's feet and says, go ahead, pick it up, boy, pick it up. When the little kid makes a reach for it, the sheriff guns him down. I'm not going to put up with this. It's so obvious what they're doing. Another example of problem, reaction, solution. And what happened because this government, this global government, armed Saddam,
yep, Saddam
with chemicals,
was framed.
Biologicals? Well, in 91, during the Gulf War, Bush wanted to get rid of the evidence, Bush Sr. So he publicly had our troops blow up all these different bunker complexes. Hundreds of them, the size of football fields. And all of this nerve gas and thousands of chemical weapons detectors went off, rained down, and the VA said, no, you're not sick. And we don't care if the chemical weapons detectors went off. You're not going to get any treatment. And tens of thousands of troops have died. And the government tried to deny it for a decade. And like they always do, they said, oh, yeah, there are atomic soldiers.
Like he's probably
right
about
Agent
Orange. The people who
oh, yeah,
did
we
have
did
that exposure
let black men
to
die
those chemicals,
for 50
but
years.
I don't think that's
oh,
part
yeah,
of
we
a
did
globalist
sterilize
agenda.
Hundreds of thousands
I think
of women
that's part
with
of
eugenics
government
and a Nazi program in America. And, oh, yeah, you were hit by sarin and VX, and we didn't treat you, but so what? When are you going to start waking up? So how did Iraq get their weapons? The globalists sold it to them.
Look at these websites.
The
they look so jank.
Our troops breathe it. But supposedly supporting the troops now means that you don't give them any treatment when they've been injured in battle. Why couldn't they treat them? Because people bring up the fact that Saddam got these weapons from our own government, and our government had our troops blow up the evidence and then breathe it. another problem, reaction, solution, another crisis, another area of government-sponsored terrorism we see is the FBI seeking 3,000 missing Iraqis in America. Of course, they don't mention in these articles that it was the U.S. government who trained these Iraqis in the 80s when Saddam was our ally, brought them back in after the Gulf War under Bush and under Clinton, and that, yes, these Iraqis were involved on the scene at Oklahoma City. No, they want to be able to use that story whenever it suits them to claim that Saddam has Iraqis here, these terror cells attacking us. And then hopefully we'll just forget about the fact that it was the U.S. government that brought them into the country in the first place.
Gosh,
bottom line, these are the CIA's Iraqis. These are not Saddam's Iraqis. That's the facts. In fact, you can go back to a
We've got the wrong Iraqis.
1993 Los Angeles Times article, headline, Iraq POWs paid to resettle in U.S. lawmakers protest. Or another article back in 93 where congressmen, 80 plus of them, warned the people that this could be dangerous. Resettling Iraqi POWs in U.S. criticized. Lawmakers urged Clinton to end potentially dangerous. And of course, when they were involved in the Oklahoma City bombing, working with their federal handlers, that was covered up so they could later link the Iraqis to the American right wing, one of the few groups actually fighting the New World Order. And years ago, I predicted they would do just that because it was clear the frame-up they were setting up.
Does this mark a shift?
Did you know
this
that police, good
that
FBI, actually arrested five
openly
members of the Iraqi Republican Guard right after the Oklahoma City bombing? They had surveillance camera tapes with the Iraqis
point,
on video with
like,
McVeigh outside.
Left and right don't
but again, they were all just patsies and decoys. The feds were inside planning the bombs.
And now
witnesses
he's like
saw
clearly
doing
pointing
it.
Out that the right wing is
Clinton
at
then
war
ordered the FBI to
the
release these Iraqis. Think about that. And they have the surveillance tape of them doing it. But then the media comes out and says, oh, Saddam's seen using proxy groups, lone wolves to attack the U.S., the left wing, the right wing. Why, they all work for Saddam. And now they can use the enemy combatant designation against the American people and strip us of our rights by creating this tenuous link. Then they had their little proxies in the media. You talk about proxies. The government started having its little moles in the media put out the headlines. Did Timothy McVeigh have Iraqi helpers? Ooh. Yeah, he had Iraqi helpers, but they don't work for Saddam. They work for the globalist. Rumsfeld, defense secretary, admits they have a group called P2OG that goes out and kills people's family members to get them to attack America so the globalists have a pretext to invade more countries. Another amazing revelation. It's all out in the open. In fact, it's now come out the U.S. helped as Saddam plotted chemical attacks, reports said in the London Guardian. Remember those nerve gas attacks back in the 1980s? Of course, I've interviewed some of the top CIA officials who were there in the 80s briefing Ronald Reagan on my radio show, and it was clear that Saddam was in a chemical weapons battle with the Iranians, but the Kurds that died actually died by a cyanide-based gas that the Iranians
used, they got from the Soviets.
Not the gas that Saddam got from the U.S.
It's always either
that's
right before or right after just
bodies.
Something completely unhinged.
In fact, back in the 80s, it was blamed on Iran. But again, using doublethink, later it's blamed on Saddam. It's incredible. And you ought
the
to see the thugs that are now planning to put in
lines,
to
folks.
Install to oppress the Iraqi people now that they've gotten rid of Bush's first business partner in Iraq, Saddam Hussein. Shifting gears, remember earlier I mentioned that it's not just the Germans controlling the neo-Nazi groups or the British blowing up their own buildings to set up a police state and blame it on their political enemies. There were a lot of articles in 2002 and 2003 in Haaretz, UPI, Reuters about Mossad. Israeli intelligence in 1973 founding Hamas. And then in 2001 and 2002, arming groups of Palestinians that are in their employ. They were caught red-handed doing this to carry out terrorist attacks so the Israelis have an excuse to expand their settlements and crack down and crush the Palestinians. Again, always look at the motive. In fact, all these mainstream articles were condensed in an amazing story in Media Bypass. But I think the story tells a thousand words. Mossad exposed in phony Palestinian Al-Qaeda caper, and you have this black glove with a lighter marked Mossad with a dynamite tied to the Israeli flag. Again, a picture does tell a thousand words. And
listen
by
to this
Mossad
really sensitive
that out, they
version
have the
of the music
to take total control of that entire region. Problem, reaction, solution, over and over again. In fact, here's the analysis: Hamas history tied to Israel, United Press International, by Richard Sale, and it details this.
Wow.
Here is another one from the Center for Research on Globalism. Israeli roots of Hamas are being exposed. Not just the roots, but modern-day terrorism controlled by Israel.
My spot is on it.
I mentioned the story out of the Sunday Herald. The Army asked me to make bombs for the IRA, told me I had the Prime Minister's blessing. Exclusive confessions of a
then
secret agent.
Then they tried to
agent.
Kill me.
British intelligence, Army intelligence. IRA torture was in the Royal Marines. Loyalist killer admits to being RUC informer. Oh, before I forget, another tidbit in this information overload. The London Guardian broke a story on March 26, 2001. It came out in court in Italy. The former head of Italian intelligence said that in the 1970s, the left wing was getting out of the control of the government. And so the CIA went in and hired the right wing to carry out terrorist attacks to be blamed on the left wing. Headline, terrorist helped by CIA to stop rise of left in Italy.
What a
so the left gets out of the control of the globalist and off the reservation, the globalist will blow stuff up and blame it on the left. If the right gets out of their control, they'll blow stuff up and blame it on the right. It's done over and over and over again. Just another example. Here's another one. Al-Qaeda suspects hidden by UK agents. Jack Straw, foreign minister for Britain, faces government grilling over Bali bombing. Turns out that they, quote, had prior knowledge and told the Bali's government not to warn the people. They also told the Taiwanese found out about it, and the U.S. government told them not to warn the folks in Bali. And the evidence shows that it was a military job, and it looks like it was done to get the Australians behind the war. A tourist bar was targeted full of Australians, and now the Australians are cracking down on their people and taking all of their liberties just over and over and over again. The families of the victims in Australia aren't sitting down and taking it quietly. They went after the Australian premier at a press conference on the Bali bombing and accused them of having knowledge or being involved. And the evidence is they were. Here's another one from the Associated Press in 2003. FBI recruited and protected violent informants nationwide for decades. And you read
yes,
the article,
absolutely.
It's come out in court. The FBI controlled mafia hitmen
and
controlled
the
drug dealing on the east and west coast and had killers going after people that were trying to stop drug dealers.
When Ben Shapiro debates somebody, like, he just keeps talking, right? Just keeps talking. So by the time that he addresses something in the beginning that you want, that's the point, and that you want to counter it, but then he talks so far past it that if you try to circle back to the original issue, then you look like you're out of the, it looks like you're avoiding, you know what I mean? It's just this flood of information, most of which has no sources, or Alex is quoting himself as the source without telling us that directly. Making it like really hard to
officers that were doing their
have any kind of discernment for what
we're hearing
or seeing. Targeted
by FBI agents using organized crime. I mean, folks, and this is the government that wants to take all your liberties under Patriot Act 2. Then you have Russia. Putin was conclusively caught by Moscow police using the new KGB, the FSB, to carry out bombings. And when a Russian media tycoon exposed the story, Putin tried to have him arrested, and he had to flee the country. There are so many other examples of government-sponsored terrorism. They've admitted under Project Shad in the 70s, they sprayed our troops with chemicals and biologicals on ships. Incredible illnesses and even some deaths resulted. They admit that they sprayed U.S. states thousands of times from Alaska to Florida. They just calmly announce it. It's not even a major news headline. That's one of the tactics the propagandists use.
Oh,
they will
boy.
Minimize massive news stories by burying them in the paper. and then have 100 reports, you know, about how to bake a cake or roast a turkey. And now the Army and Homeland Security are announcing that they're going to have biological spraying of Bacillus thuringiensis, a dangerous bacteria, over many areas of Oklahoma.
Now, people in Oklahoma have been talking to me about this tonight and saying, you know, anything coming out of a plane landing on my state, I think that seems suspicious. And the folks I've talked to tonight say they're feeling a sense of homeland insecurity.
Again, just setting the precedent, they can spray us whenever they want. Here's another headline. Records, U.S. did open-air biological chemical weapons test in Florida. Again, Associated Press. Chemical weapons test by the U.S. in the 60s against servicemen. Here was a Sunday Herald story out of Britain revealed how naval intelligence tested lethal plague bombs off Scotland.
I'm not even doubting
Horton Down used soldiers for sarin gas tests. In 1983, deadly gas.
Seen our government do some pretty horrific things.
Red Cross faces
but again,
scrutiny.
I don't think
Sydney Morning Herald.
Being
they
motivated
got caught. The federal
by
government yesterday ordered
government.
An inquiry into the deliberate use of potentially contaminated blood to make medical products used by thousands of hospitals, patients, and hemophiliacs. And it says they told people giving blood, we don't care if you have hepatitis C, give us blood, and publicly put it in the blood supply. Here's another
that
one.
That headline said that they were putting an inquiry into the fact
on.
That that
Eugenics.
Happened.
Nazi program.
Is how I
they
read
call
it anyway.
Bioethics today. Here's another one. Britain toy with ethnic cleansing. Leaders considered forcibly moving Roman Catholics to Irish Republic. This stuff comes out every day. They just calmly announce it. They're behind all the terror. We've never found a terrorist incident of any real size or scope that was carried out by anyone but the government. There's a few lone nuts that do a few badly coordinated, tiny attacks, but every major attack is controlled by the globalists and their provocateurs.
The globalists.
I just want you to realize who we're dealing with, who we're facing here, America. A bunch of criminal hoodlums, military-industrial complex minions using Madison Avenue advertising, propaganda,
well,
brainwashing technique to neutralize opposition to the New World Order.
Well, that's what
they got you to deny its
existence
while they were
building
the
chemtrails,
this worldwide
like we go
police
from
state for
the
total
biological
enslavement. Now it's upon you, and they're saying
spray downs,
or the
getting hosed
get
down
you.
To
wake
into
up,
the
man,
chemtrails.
Your kids are worth it. The truth is getting out to the American people. And as the liberals and the conservatives wake up to the fact that we have manufactured consent in this country, and that there's no real debate about serious issues, just simply staged theatrical events, we can begin to get our Bill of Rights and Constitution back. All Americans should be constitutionalists, because the Constitution, Bill of Rights, and the Declaration of Independence state the facts of history. Governments become tyrannical. They attempt to dominate populations, and they must be resisted. And mistrust of government, a watchful nature must
you need a remix of the Alex Jones, they can spray us whenever they want. It might be out there.
Elites throughout history have wanted just a few things. To expand their control and to maintain that control and to block any rivals to that control. And to do that, they have to dumb down populations. They have to create terrorist acts to scare them into submission. And the New World Order is simply the latest in a long line of empires, of strong men, of king rats that have attempted to dominate and abuse their populations. And they can't help it. They will always abuse their populations because their own minions, their own servants, their own enforcers enjoy abusing people. They're sadistic, and they like to expand their own little mini empires inside of a tyrannical, dehumanizing, total enslavement program. It is the law of the jungle. It is the law of world history. And as a great statesman said, those that don't know history are doomed to repeat it. Power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And I know this, resistance to tyrants is obedience to God. Let's look at the Patriot Act 1 and 2 and what Homeland Security sets up here in the United States. Using the pretext of terror, in the wake of September 11th, tragedy, the federal government passed the Patriot Act II. Members of Congress were not even allowed to read it. They were ordered by committee chairmen to go out on the floor and vote for something they had never read. Patriot Act I destroyed large sections of the Bill of Rights. It annihilated the First, Third, Fourth, Fifth Amendment seriously damaged the Seventh and the Tenth. Now there's Patriot Act II. As if Patriot Act I wasn't good enough. Congressman Ron Paul, when speaking to Insight Magazine, told them that no member of Congress was allowed to read the first Patriot Act that was passed by the House on October 27, 2001. The first Patriot Act was universally decried by civil libertarians and constitutional scholars from across the political spectrum. William Safire, while writing for the New York Times, described the first Patriot Act's powers by saying that President Bush was seizing dictatorial control. On February 7, 2003, the Center for Public Integrity, a nonpartisan public interest think tank,
it is inarguable,
in D.C., revealed the full
text
of the Domestic Security Enhancement Act 2003. The classified document had been leaked to them by an unnamed source inside the federal government.
Some of
the
document
consisted of a 33-page section by section analysis and the accompanying 87-page bill.
A lot of things.
And all this time, after they were caught, the White House tried to deny
it.
There is not a proposed Terrorist Act II.
Then it turned out the bill had actually already been introduced as S-22 by the Democrats. In fact, the title was almost identical. Whereas the House version was the Domestic Security Enhancement Act, the Senate version was the Justice and Domestic Security Enhancement Act of 2003.
It was not
an overreaction. The only difference with the Senate version is it's full of gun control laws, like Our Lady of Peace Act, that registers gun owners, the National Ballistics Database,
and you're an
shuts
Alex
down
Jones fan,
private
you're like,
sellers
well, wait,
at gun
Alex
shows,
said they create
just
these situations
the
so that they can put these
gun control act.
Things
by the way,
in place,
Republicans
and then
are
when you actually see that happen, then it's easy probably for some people to attribute it to the causes
has also
that
been
Alex
introduced.
Jones says.
It's the Universal National Service Act of 2003, and let me tell you, it's the hallmark of a command and control society. The description of the bill is to provide for the common defense by requiring that all young persons in the United States, including women, perform a period of military service or civilian service in furtherance of the national defense and homeland security and for other purposes. We have looked
now,
at some of the programs the federal government has already been setting up for national service here in the
service,
new homeland, and they include East German-style tattletale squads of every type, which are just basically a super tips program. It's similar to programs they've had in Russia since Stalin's era and continuing to this day, where they take junior high and high school students and train them in warrant service, gun confiscation, tax police, fugitive apprehension, you name it. Literal Hitler Jugend,
brown shirts. I'm down here
at
the high school. We've got a guy that looks like he's really great at tax enforcement.
And teaching them the finer points of collecting taxes. And teaching them to do this. These are their role models, Russia's rough and ready tax police. They knock on the door, you know it's time to pay your taxes. They wear black masks and are famous for beating up tax cheats and the Russian mafia. Their motto, we have guns and we know how to use them.
The Patriot Act II bill itself is stamped confidential, not for distribution. Upon reading the analysis of the bill, I was stunned by the systematically crafted tyranny contained in the legislation. The Justice Department Office of Legislative Affairs admits that they have indeed covertly transmitted a copy of legislation to Speaker of the House, Dennis Hastert, and of course, we already told you the Democrats have already introduced the bill. And there's dozens of sections in it, actually hundreds of sections in it, but Section 501 allows them to strip Americans of their citizenship and designate them for enemy combatants under Section 802 of the first Patriot Act that reads, any action that endangers human life that is a violation of any federal or state law. Now understand, you think this is just for, you know, Habib Ahmed,
I don't know.
The terrorist
it was another one of those things where
Jordan,
we saw
so
little
think
of it that it was
you.
Hard to gauge
it
exactly,
says over
but it
and over
seemed
again,
to me like
to fight international terrorism,
you had
domestic terrorism,
people learning
and crime.
About taxes
the definition
in
of terrorism,
why it was
again,
important to
any action
tax
that endangers human life
to collect
that violates
tax.
Any federal or state law.
And then that
that's
was
the first Patriot Act.
Super
they now say in Patriot Act II that they'll strip you of citizenship, secretly arrest you,
militia group, I guess, that goes and collects taxes for Vladimir Putin. I feel like there was a jump in there that
I mean, Hitler didn't even have the nerve to put stuff like that
to me,
down on paper.
I guess,
he just
but I don't
did
believe.
It. You're thinking, hey, Patriot Act II hasn't passed. Well, as soon as they engineer a terrorist attack, it will. And they've even said that if there's another terrorist attack, they'll pass it.
The war on terrorism was not just 9/11. That was just one of the battles. When you go to the grocery store and when you go to the football arena or other places, you have to think about these things differently.
Well, what is Mike Ditka, look what they set up here. Or what?
Every time there's attack, they take more liberties while they leave the border wide open. Just a few more attacks, we'll be more enslaved than somebody in Soviet Russia. And it also has a subsection where if you know that your neighbor was grabbed by the police and you tell anyone, you can be designated as a terrorist and then be grabbed. I mean, this is something out of Alexander Solzhenitsyn's Gulag Archipelago, but worse. And right here in America, Section 501, the enemy combatant designation. And they're already grabbing citizens under this, and federal courts are saying that they can do this because there is no constitutional rights during the war on terror.
That's what happened. They sprayed
Alex Jones. It is my responsibility to provide a legal framework and context in which detentions are understood and sustained.
What a perfect war. Some shadowy enemy you can never catch, and of course it's the government, carrying out these attacks, and the war just goes on and on and on. Section 201 of the Second Patriot Act makes it a criminal act for any member of the government or citizen to release any information concerning the incarceration or whereabouts of detainees. It also states that law enforcement does not even have to tell the press who they have arrested, and they never have to release their names. That's what we always heard about Guatemala or Communist China or Cuba. They just, Felipe, they came and got him and he's gone and you don't talk about it. Section 311 gives immunity to law enforcement engaging in spying operations against the American people.
We're going beyond governments. We're going into the hearts and minds of individuals.
There's more sections who say that private corporations can spy on you and have no liability. They even state in some of the other sections that
in the previous documentaries are like, you know, kind of
any rights under the Fourth Amendment, and that police don't even have to get secret warrants anymore, that they can just break in your home if they feel like without a warrant, take whatever they want and never tell you they were there, or plant things there. My friends, you have got to read Patriot Act 2, and you've got to read our analysis of it at Infowars.com. Section by section, you can then go to the bill, the House and Senate version, look at it for yourself. We've been analyzing the House version here for you, section by section. It's just the end of America. There's no other way to describe it.
Invasion of privacy. How omniscient government supercomputers can work for you.
Losing something can be so frustrating. It's hard to remember where we put things. And psychics can be so expensive. But thanks to the new Department of Homeland Security, losing something will soon be a thing of the past. I'm the Constitution hugger. Hey guys, where are my keys? Thanks. You guys are sweethearts.
Homeland Security is every patriot's duty. You can get into the act too.
But Stephen, you're probably being recorded as saying, doesn't all this government spying on its citizens mean losing our basic freedoms? Of course not. It means gaining limits on those freedoms. Something Uncle Sam likes to call.
Do I think he regrets it? No, because playing the character,
and there's so many more benefits.
Like,
in a fear-based economy, everybody's a spy. Total surveillance means total employment. Also,
all additional benefits classified under the United States Patriot Act of 2001. For further information about these benefits, report to federal detention centers. Happy clown candy centers.
Of course, not everybody can handle that much freedom. For those who absolutely need their privacy,
folks,
these
when
convenient
Colbert
privacy boxes are just the ticket to get
right
away from it all.
Comedy Central.
I'm Stephen Colbert.
You know
I hope you've learned something tonight, but most of all, I hope you enjoy the police state.
Attorney General John Ashcroft, shortly after the passage of the first Patriot Act in the aftermath of September 11th in late 2001, told a Senate panel in Congress that the Patriot Act didn't take anyone's liberties, and that people that talked about phantoms of lost liberties were aiding the terrorist, and that they would lose their liberties, that they were adding to the fog of war. Talk about double speak.
Okay, I'm not going to rewind it or anything, but that was very strange. That's clippable. That was nuts. That was one of the weirdest cadences I've ever heard. That was disturbing to me.
Not taking your liberties, but if you say we're taking your liberties, you aid the enemy, we'll take your liberties. But he one-upped himself when it comes to out-and-out bald-faced lies.
He was going for, like, in weight and gravitas
while testifying before the House.
On his, like, delivery, and I thought it just completely crashed and
Mr.
burned.
Ashcroft,
but I,
upon being questioned
fantastic.
About Patriot Act 2 that dwarfs Patriot Act 1 and its police state provisions, they said, tell us about Patriot Act 2, which everybody has a copy of and has been introduced in the Senate. And Mr. Ashcroft said, there is no Patriot Act 2. Well, I guess in lawyers speak, he was telling the truth. The actual title of what is now known as Patriot Act 2 is the Domestic Security Enhancement Act of 2001.
Yeah, I think this is more semantics, what Alex is saying. They treated it like it was just a DLC for the original Patriot Act. And Alex and a lot of other people see it as basically just Patriot Act 2 because it was, you know, more substantial than just a, you know, a minor DLC add-on or whatever.
So let's go to some clips of Ashcroft back in 2001 saying they're not taking your liberty and then lying again in 2003 saying there is no Patriot Act 2.
Under Director Bob Mueller, the FBI is undergoing an historic reorganization to put the prevention of terrorism at the center of its law enforcement and national security effort. Outside Washington, we are forging new relationships of cooperation with state and local law enforcement. We've created 93 anti-terrorism task forces across the country in each U.S. Attorney's District to integrate the communications and activities of state, local, and federal law enforcement. In all of these ways and more, the Department of Justice has sought to prevent terrorism with reason, careful balance, and excruciating attention to detail. Some of our critics, I regret to say, have shown less affection for detail. Their bold declaration of so-called facts have quickly dissolved upon inspection into vague conjecture. Charges of kangaroo courts and shredding the Constitution give new meaning to the term fog of war.
Feel like it.
Since lives and liberties depend on clarity, not obfuscation, and upon reason, not hyperbole, let me take this opportunity to be clear. Each action taken by the Department of Justice, as well as the war crimes commissions considered by the President and the Department of Defense, is carefully drawn to target a narrow class of individuals, terrorists. Our legal powers are targeted at terrorists. Our investigation is focused on terrorists. Our prevention strategy targets the terrorist threat. The United States government has defined terrorists as those who perpetrate premeditated, politically motivated violence against non-combatant targets. My message to America this morning, then, is this. If you fit this definition of a terrorist, fear the United States, for you will lose your liberty. We need honest, reasoned debate, not fear-mongering. To those who pit Americans against immigrants and citizens against non-citizens, to those who scare peace-loving people with phantoms of lost liberty,
he's like, hey,
my message
we have
is
a
this.
That guy getting kicked in the your nuts has been on like 100 times in these Alex Jones videos.
Senator, with your permission, I'd like to respond to the suggestion that there is a Patriot Act 2. When individuals indicate to you that if there is a proposal, we'll confer with you, I believe they are right. There is not a proposed Terrorist Act 2 from the Justice Department.
I want history to judge you as the one who, during a very difficult period, tried to strike a balance and not one who allowed people to get carried away to a point where we hurt ourselves and threw away our Constitution.
Oh, boy.
Man, it took a lot of nerve, didn't it, for him to get up there and say that? But Ashcroft is counting on you to be stupid, to be fool.
All right. Ashcroft wants you to be stupid. I'm gonna take a real quick break here before we come back for part two.